Good morning. Welcome to today's webinar. A special thanks to Hotchkiss Insurance Agency for being the 2018 TNLA webinar sponsor. For today's webinar, you will see a drop-down menu at the right side of your screen. As questions come up during the conversation today, please use the chat feature in that menu to type in your questions. Sometimes it is better to hold off asking these questions until the last 10 minutes of the presentation due to your question might be answered towards the end of the presentation. At the end of the webinar, we will get to as many of these questions as possible. Cynthia Ramos, formerly of Corpus Christi, Texas, moved to San Antonio in 1997 to begin her career with the United States Department of Labor, Wage, and Hour. She is a graduate of Corpus Christi State University and Texas A&M University, Corpus Christi. As an investigator, she conducted many investigations covering the numerous laws enforced by wage and hour. In 2006, Cynthia was promoted to Assistant District Director, and in 2012, she was promoted to District Director of San Antonio District Office. She supervises a staff of 17 employees who oversee Bexar County and 26 surrounding counties. Now, let me hand over the mic to let Cindy get started. You might experience a brief pause. Okay, Cynthia, I think you are ready to rock and roll.
Okay, great. Let me just, I was about to leave the, okay. So, well, thank you so much for having us here this morning. I appreciate the invitation, and hopefully the information that we provide this morning will be very beneficial to you. If you have any questions, at the end of my presentation, I'm going to give our phone number, so you are more than welcome to call our number here in San Antonio. We have two technicians who answer the phones, and if they cannot get to your call, please leave a message, and within 24 hours, you should receive a response. So because we have quite a bit of information, I'm going to go ahead and get started. And towards the end, I will try to answer all your questions. If not, for sure, I'll get back somehow or other to, you know, provide answers to your questions. So thank you again for the invitation. So what I'm going to be going over this morning is the Fair Labor Standards Act. Let me just say something. Are you seeing that? That's over here. I'm trying to get rid of this dial on screen. Are y'all seeing that as well?
No, ma'am. We don't see the dialogue screen. We just see your PowerPoint.
Okay, great. Okay, great. So I'm going to be going over the Fair Labor Standards Act. That's just one of the many acts we enforce. We also enforce the Family Medical Leave Act, the Davis-Bacon Act, which covers construction on a federal project, Service Contract Act, which is also a government on a government contract. We enforce the Migrant Seasonal and Protection Act. Those are for migrant workers. We enforce the contracts on H-1B, H-2A, and H-2B workers. So those are just a list of some of the acts that we enforce. The most popular one, of course, is the Fair Labor Standards Act, and that's the one we're going to be discussing this morning. So this is just a little disclaimer about my presentation. So these are some of the issues under the Fair Labor Standards Act or provisions that we're going to cover. Coverage, minimum wage, overtime, youth employment, or better known as child labor regulations, and record keeping. So coverage. So when we look at an employer's business, for the most part, we usually have jurisdiction in every business. There's over 135 million workers in the US, 7 million workplaces that are protected and covered by the Fair Labor Standards Act. So pretty much we have coverage in all the businesses. But before we make that determination, we have to determine what type of coverage do we have, if in fact we have any, because sometimes it happens that we have no coverage, therefore we would have no jurisdiction in that business. So the first one and the most easiest one for an investigator to determine is enterprise coverage. And if a business makes $500,000 or more, or generates sales of $500,000 or more a year, and then most likely their business is covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act. If they fall below that, that doesn't mean we go away. We look at every individual employee that is working there, because they might individually be covered based on what they're doing. So as I stated, an enterprise coverage, they have to make no less than $500,000 a year. They'll have, you know, the employees will be producing, handling, selling, or working on goods that, you know, have moved in interstate commerce. That means they've moved in and out of state. And they have to have two or more employees that are engaged in this commerce. So for nonprofit organizations, we have no coverage unless the nonprofit organization is involved in some type of commercial activities. And the best example I can come up with is, say, for instance, a church. So there are a lot of churches that they'll have a gift store, and maybe they sell books or they sell any kind of gifts. If that portion of the church grosses $500,000 or more, then of course it would fall under their enterprise concept. Or say that they don't, that it's maybe they make $250,000 a year. Well, the individual that works in that gift store, if they accept credit cards, that's one avenue of interstate commerce, that person would be individually covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act. There's also what the regulations have deemed as named enterprises. And what we call as these named enterprises, they include hospitals, residential, medical, or nursing care facilities, schools, preschools, and government agencies. So if we run across one of these businesses, or say we get a complaint from someone who works at one of these businesses, there would be no coverage. We automatically have jurisdiction in those facilities, and we would automatically go in and conduct an investigation. We don't have to have any type of coverage. It would be regardless of what their sales are. Okay, so that's that. So individual coverage. As I stated before, individual coverage relies on what the employee's activities are. So say we go into a business, say it's a medical business, and they don't make the annual gross volume that we're looking at, then they may actually have someone who maybe works in billing, and that person sends information across state lines to insurance companies, or maybe even credit card companies, because they accept credit cards as a payment. So that individual would be individually covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act. And we would look at that on a work week basis, a work week to work week basis. Again, just that to cover, it's interstate commerce, the production of goods for interstate commerce. So those are the activities. For instance, say you're in a restaurant and it's a small little restaurant. They don't make the gross volume that we're looking at, but the restaurant uses the credit card machine. So the wait staff takes your credit card, takes it up to the counter, processes your credit card, brings you back the information. Well, the use of the telephone lines is the use of interstate commerce, because information is going across state lines, coming back to that restaurant and giving them information whether your credit card was accepted or not. So that process is, you know, moving goods in interstate commerce. Some people actually, like a manufacturing company, they work on goods here, they assemble one part of it, or they do one, produce one part of it, and then it goes on to another state maybe, and something else is added onto it. That is working on goods that are moving in interstate commerce. Another type of individual coverage is domestic service or home care. So someone, you may have like maybe a live-in person or someone who maybe comes and cleans your home. Those people are automatically covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act. And then of course we talked about the nonprofits, the person that works in the gift store that maybe accepts credit cards, that person would be individually covered even though they work for a nonprofit organization. So these are just some bullet points on what makes you covered under individual coverage. You know, making out-of-state phone calls, receiving or sending emails electronically, or maybe you have to pick up the phone and call somebody out of state to get information. So, you know, using the phone at least once a week would make you covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act. Maybe there's someone in the organization that orders goods. That's their specific role, is inventory. And so maybe not on a weekly basis, but maybe one, you know, out of the month, 1 week they order supplies. Then that, in that 1 week, they would be covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act. And then, of course, as I mentioned before, the credit card transactions. That activity makes you covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act. So all that is covered under, would the employee would be subject under the individual coverage. And so the employer would be responsible for making sure that that employee is subject to the Fair Labor Standards Act. So everything that comes along with that, you know, at least getting paid minimum wage, overtime, keeping records, all that, the employer would be subject to all those provisions of the Fair Labor Standards Act. So basically, just to recap on coverage, so almost every employee in the U.S. is covered by the Fair Labor Standards Act. It's a very broad concept, and as I stated before, when someone comes in to file a complaint, or we decide that we're gonna, you know, we're gonna go look at this business, the first thing we have to determine is, do we have coverage? Because if we don't have coverage, then we have no jurisdiction in that business. So that would be under, you know, that's just the concept under coverage. So minimum wage. So if you are covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act and your business meets all the criteria, then as an employer, you're responsible for making sure that your employees are earning at least minimum wage. And the current minimum wage is $7.25. A lot of times what we find is employers will take deductions for, you know, uniforms, for tools, for broken items. And if we find, if you have a minimum wage employee that all they're making is $7.25, then you've brought them below minimum wage if you make these deductions. They're considered illegal deductions when they bring somebody below minimum wage. So you want to be careful with that. If the employee is making, $8 an hour, then if I do the math correctly, I think that's 75 cents difference between $7.25 and $8 an hour. So you want to make sure that you don't bring them below the minimum wage. So you can deduct whatever the difference between, you know, well, the 75 cents times, say they work 40 hours. I have a calculator here handy real quick. So you could deduct $30 before you brought them below minimum wage. So you want to be careful with that, because I know that a lot of employers practice that. They take deductions. And even though it is an illegal deduction, but if we get calls all the time and some of these employees are paid, you know, way better than $7.25. And so if the employer in taking that deduction doesn't bring them below minimum wage, then there's nothing we can do under the federal law, because there's they didn't bring them below 725. So you just want to be real careful with that. Okay, so now we're going to talk a little bit about hours worked and what constitute hours worked. That's another common area that we find employers usually are not aware of what their responsibilities are. And so they'll allow the employee to work certain hours, but they don't count them because let's say an employee comes in, early, 15 minutes before their scheduled time to start, getting, they work in the office. And so they have to, turn on their computer and whatnot and be ready to go by a certain time. They'll come in early and they're actually working, but the employer doesn't start their pay, their time until their scheduled time. So those times have to be counted as hours worked. If an employee is called into work, like for instance, in a restaurant, and I'm probably gonna use that a lot as an example. So say the employee comes in and their section of the restaurant isn't busy. They have no customers and they're waiting. The employer sometimes doesn't allow them to clock in until their section gets busy. Well, that's a violation of the act because they're there, they're waiting for work. So you have to pay them that for that wait time. So here's a little chart on what is hours worked and what is not hours worked. So if an employee is what they call waiting time, so like my example, if they're waiting to get work, then the employer is responsible for counting that time as hours worked. But if the employee is completely relieved of duties, say that they're a delivery driver maybe, and so they get their deliveries, they have two or three deliveries and they deliver all their items, and then they're free to do whatever until they get their next call, say 2 or 3 hours later, then the employer calls them and says, okay, we have another delivery. Well, that time that they're free and clear to do what they want, and it's considered a reasonable time for them to take care of personal business, then that time would not be considered hours worked. The regulations also give a pretty good explanation of what hours worked is, what waiting time is. So if you have any questions, certainly you can Google that and it gives a really good explanation on that. On call time. So we usually get a lot of calls from employees because a lot of times they'll go on call, say for example, they'll go on call at 5 o'clock on Friday till 8 o'clock in the morning on Monday. So they think, okay, I should be paid for this entire time, all these hours. But in actuality, if the employee is allowed to do, their own personal business, go and come as they please, because most people have a cell phone nowadays, and as long as they can reach you and you're available, you can do whatever you want. Even in your own home, you're free to watch whatever you want, do your laundry, go outside. You know, that is not, all that time is not considered the on-call paid time. What the employer would be responsible for paying is the minute the employee gets a call, then the employer should log down that time, record that time. All the time that they're on the phone trying to resolve a situation or take care of an issue, that time only should be paid time. So an employee, if they're on call, they should, the employer should tell them, okay, this is your responsibility. Make sure you track all these calls and the time that it takes you to resolve the issue, because that's the only time the employer would be responsible for paying. Unless the employer makes them stay on premises and they have to stay at the employer's premises, then that's different. Then they have to be paid for that time. Meal breaks. This is a huge issue that we have, especially like in construction and stuff. So because people are away from their business. So what we enforce when it comes to meal periods is, if the employee did not take the meal period, did they get paid? Because we don't enforce meal periods. So if an employer tells you you're working 8 hours a day with no meal breaks and they pay you for the 8 hours, there's no violation. But what we come in and look at is if an employee tells us, well, I get, you know, do you get a meal break? Yes. How long do you get? 15 minutes, maybe, and then I have to go back to work. Well, that's not considered a true rest or meal period. So the employer would be responsible for paying that. So that's, those are things that we look at. So typically what we look at is a meal period is usually 30 minutes or more. So if it's 30 minutes or more, the employer can take that deduction. Also, a lot of employers will allow 2 15-minute breaks, one in the morning and one in the afternoon, and that's fine. But again, those times have to be paid. The employer cannot deduct them. And so we see that a lot, that employers make that error when it comes to breaks. Also, the employee has to be completely relieved from any kind of duty. So in other words, let's say that they sit at their desk or they're at the counter and they're consistently being interrupted by phone calls or customers that are coming to the counter, then that's not being relieved of your duty. Therefore, that time, even though they're eating, that time has to be paid because they have to be completely relieved of their duty. Okay, training time. So on this slide, it says time spent in meetings, lectures, or training is considered hours worked and must be paid unless. So this, and this is real confusing, and even in the regs. So in order for the employer not to pay the employee, these four bullet points have to be met. Okay, so the attendance would have to be outside regular work hours. The attendance has to be voluntary. So in other words, the employee wants to do this. The course or training or meeting that they're going to cannot be job related. And the employee does not perform any productive work. So if all this is met, then the employer does not have to pay this training time. But if the employer is requiring the employee to go to a training, even though it, you know, it's outside hours, work hours, then he must pay for that time. Travel time. Okay, this is another problem that we see a lot in different types of industries. So ordinary work to home is not considered compensable time. Okay, it's not hours paid. So my drive time from my home to my work, or in the afternoon from my work to my home, that time is not considered paid time. However, travel that's between job sites in the normal workday is considered work time. So if I go from job A, then I finish there and I go to job B and job C, and that takes me the whole 8 hours, that time, the travel time between each job site is considered travel time. And there are some special rules. So just to give a little bit more information on this, say that you have workers and they have to report to the job site to pick up tools, to load the truck, and then they all get into one vehicle and they travel to the first job site. The time that they get to the employer's place of business, or to the yard as some people call it, once they get there and they start loading the vehicle or getting instructions for the day, their time starts there. And their time is continuous all day. When they finish at their last job site, if they still have to come back to the employer's place of business to unload the vehicle, clean the truck, or whatever, their time is still continuous until they're completely relieved of their duties. And then, of course, their time to their home is not considered work time. So that's real important. Sometimes you'll have a job outside of the area, like maybe, let's say, maybe to Austin. So everybody will come to the job site, they'll load the vehicle with the tools and whatnot, and then say they leave at 6 in the morning because they want to beat all the traffic, and their job is going to start at by 8 o'clock because of the traffic going to Austin. Their normal work hours on a normal day is 8 to 5, but they leave the job site at 6 o'clock. The employer would only be responsible for paying the entire trip to the driver. Now, the ones that are passengers in the vehicle, and I think we might cover this in another slide, I'm not too sure. But the ones that are passengers in the vehicle, their time does not start until their normal work hours. So for instance, they leave at 6 o'clock and they're still commuting and it's now 8 o'clock, their time doesn't start until 8 o'clock because they're passengers. That's just a position that the Department of Labor has taken. If you're a passenger on a vehicle, an airplane, a boat, a train, only the time that crosses your regular work schedule is when your time would start. That includes Saturday and Sunday as well. Unless you're the driver, then that's a little bit different. We do have, you know, in some industries where there's sleep time, if the shift is less than 24 hours, so say it's 22 hours, then the entire time would be considered work time, even if the employee is allowed to sleep. However, if the duty or the shift is 24 hours or more, then there can be an agreement between the employer and the employee. So this usually happens, this type of situation usually happens with like firefighters, EMS, that type of industry. So, they're allowed to make, usually it's 8 hours of sleep, but if the employee doesn't get the actual 8 hours because they're actually interrupted all the time with calls and whatnot, then we look at, okay, did they at least get 5 hours of sleep? If they didn't, what's considered reasonable, if they didn't get at least 5 hours of sleep, then the employer would be responsible for paying for the whole time. This can also happen when you have those type of residential care places, or some people have care personnel that come and stay with, you know, like an elderly person and they live there with them, or they take the night shift. But if they live with them, well, that's 24 hours. So they would come to an agreement as to how many hours they would get of sleep, how many meals they would get, and how long, you know, the meal period would be. And then we would take a look at that and make sure the employer is recording that accurately and paying it accurately. So just to recap, these are just some of the common, these are the topics that we discussed, and these some common issues that we run into. You know, suffered or permitted is for the employer, you know, allows someone to work off the clock and they don't consider those hours when, you know, when they're paying them. Sometimes employers will put into policy that, you know, you're only allowed to work 8 hours, and if you work any more than that, you know, I'm not going to pay you. Well, if something happens and the employee does have to go over that allotted time, then and they're doing something for the benefit of that business, the employer is responsible for paying them for that. Wait time, again, if they have to wait because a piece of equipment hasn't arrived at the job site, or maybe a machine broke down and they got to wait for somebody to fix it, that waiting time is hours worked. On call, it's any time while the person is on call, it's any time that that person is actually receiving or taking a call, or you know, taking care of whatever the issue is, the time that they're doing that is considered hours worked. Meal and rest periods, if the employee does not take the meal break, then the employer is responsible for tracking that and paying them at the end of the work week. Training time, again, if the employer requires the employee to go to training, then he has to pay for that. But if all those four issues we talked about in that previous slide, if all of that is met, then the employer doesn't have to be responsible for paying for that time. And again, these are just some other issues that we run across. The required minimum wage, and an employer can pay, they can pay with a check or they can pay cash, but at the end of the pay period, they have to make sure that they paid at least minimum wage, $7.25 an hour for all hours worked or better. If you take any deductions, you want to make sure that they're not illegal deductions that bring somebody below minimum wage. If you take deductions for, you know, a broken tool or the use of a tool or uniforms that have a logo, the company logo, then those are considered illegal deductions if they bring the employee below minimum wage. Tipped employees, those are usually, you know, anybody who customarily receives tips, for instance, in the restaurant. The employer is allowed to pay a cash wage of at least $2.13 an hour, but they have to make sure that the employee makes up the difference in tips to yield at least $7.25 an hour. And then, of course, hours worked, employer has to make sure that they're recording their hours, because at the end of the week, you want to make sure that whatever you paid them divided by the number of hours they worked yields at least minimum wage or better. Okay, moving on to overtime. So overtime is when someone works more than 40 hours in a work week, and the employer is responsible for paying them at time and a half of their regular rate of pay. So we look at everything on a work week by work week basis. So a work week is 7 consecutive days, 24-hour periods. So it adds up to 168 hours. So the employer can set the work week. An employer can say, okay, I'm going to use a calendar and I'm going to go Sunday through Saturday, or their work week can be Monday through Sunday, or they can even say, you know, it's going to be Tuesday through Monday. Whatever the employer sets, that's the work week we're going to use. But once the employer sets the work week, it has to remain constant. They can't change it back and forth. So that's what we're going to use. If we come to an establishment and an employer never set a work week, then we're going to set it for you. And that's how we're going to look at the hours and determine how we're going to look at how you paid them. Some employers, and I'm just going to throw this out there, some employers pay on a semi-monthly basis, and that's okay. A semi-monthly basis is every 15 days. However, you have to make sure that you go back and you look at the hours that are worked, because sometimes it'll fall where your work week started and your pay period started, say, on a Wednesday, and, you know, 15 days after that it ends. Well, you have to come back and look at that first week, because it started on a Wednesday. If your employee worked on Monday and Tuesday, you have to see how many hours that was, because in that work week, they could have worked some overtime, and you'll be responsible for paying that. And that can be confusing if you're not sure how to look at that. So that's for people who pay on a semi-monthly basis. So we sometimes see employers stumble with that. So a regular rate is determined by dividing the total compensation, which is the total earnings, divided by the total hours, gives you the regular rate. And again, the regular rate should be at least $7.25 an hour. That's what the federal minimum wage is currently. And also in the state of Texas, it is also $7.25 an hour. So you also, when you're considering the total compensation, an employer must consider also, and if you look at that last bullet there, it also considers if any commissions are paid, if any tips are received, cost of room and board, any bonuses, all that has to be considered in the total compensation when you're trying to figure out the regular rate for the employee. So we're going to go over a few slides here with some examples on how to do the computation. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and put this up here. Let's see. Okay, so if you just look at in this particular exercise, the employee is paid $9 an hour, and they received a $10 bonus, and in this week, they worked 48 hours. So if you look at the right side of the screen, So the employee, again, worked received $9 an hour. They worked 48 hours, which equals $432. They also received a $10 bonus, so we're going to add that in to the $432, which gave them $442. And then they worked 48 hours, so we're going to divide their total compensation, which is $442, by 48 hours, which gives them a new regular rate of $9.21. So you paid them now for all their hours. So to compute the overtime, you take the regular rate of $9.21 times 0.5, because that's halftime. That gives you $4.61 times the number of hours of overtime, which was 8 hours of overtime. So the employer is responsible for paying an additional $36.88 for overtime. And then you would just add that to the regular pay of $442. So total compensation owed is $478.88. This next exercise is two different job classifications. So a lot of times you'll have an employee work two different roles. So in this example, they're a janitor. They make $8.50. They work 21 hours as a janitor. They also worked as a cook. And as a cook, the employer paid them $9 an hour, and they worked 26 hours at that rate. So they worked a total of 47 hours for that week. So the employer would compute, and this example is how to pay, like with the two different classifications, and it's what we call a weighted average. So 21 hours at $8.50 for the janitor position is $178.50. Then, let's see. Oh, and then as a cook, he worked 26 hours at $9 an hour. So those earnings are $234. So then you would add both of those earnings together, and that gives you $412.50. So if you divide that $412.50 by 47 hours, it gives you a regular rate of $8.78. Again, the employer has paid for all hours, so all he owes is halftime for the overtime. So the regular rate of 878 times 0.5 gives you $4.39. $4.39 times the 7 overtime hours yields $30.73, and so then you would just add that to your earnings of $4.12 to $412.50, and the total due is $443.23. This next example is if you pay by the piece, because an employer can pay by the hour, they can pay by the piece, they can pay a salary. However, if that is a non-exempt employee and they work overtime, the employer needs to make sure they compensate them for that overtime. So this example, the employee was a piece rate employee. They worked 46 hours and they computed earnings of $391. Okay, and they worked again 46 hours. And they had some wait time and some production time. So let's do this step by step. Okay, so the $391 for the pieces that they worked at 46 hours. They had some wait time of 4 hours, so the employer paid that at $7.25, because you can pay that at minimum wage. So like, say drive time, waiting time, the employer can pay that at a minimum wage rate, which is $7.25. So that yielded $29. They also had a production bonus of $12.50. So the total straight time earnings, so if you add $391, $29, and $12.50, that gives you $432.50. So now we want to find out what their regular rate is, because that's all their earnings. So now we divide all the earnings by 50 hours, gives us a regular rate of $8.65. So to figure the overtime, we now take the regular rate of 865 times 0.5, and that gives us $4.33. $4.33 times 10 overtime hours gives us $43.30. And when we add that all together, the employee should get $475.80. Now, there are some exemptions to overtime. Some exemptions we require an exemption of minimum wage and overtime. Depending on the job classification, it might just be an exemption from overtime. So normally what we run across is what the regulations call 541 exemptions or white collar exemptions. Those white collar exemptions pertain to like managers and supervisors, people who are considered in professional positions and outside sales positions. And there's some criteria for each one of those categories. If you're a manager, you have to earn at least $455 a week, a guaranteed salary. You have to supervise two or more full-time employees, and then there's some other criteria that goes along with that. If you're professional, there's certain job classifications that are considered professional. Not all, just because you went to college and you have a degree doesn't mean, oh, you're professionally exempt. No, there's certain criteria for that as well. And then outside sales, it's a person that is away from their employer's place of business at least 80% of the time. They only come back for incidental stuff like to return messages, fill out contracts, use the phone, but the majority of their time they're doing outside sales. So there are exemptions for minimum wage and overtime for those type of positions. So then again, some common overtime violations that we see is an employer failing to include a commission or a bonus, a piece rate that's not calculated correctly. Those are some deficiencies that we see in figuring out the regular rate, or an employer forgetting to combine hours. For instance, sometimes we see an employer that has numerous locations and they'll have to send an employee to go work at a different location, and they'll pay those out, the hours that they'll pay them with at the different locations. In other words, they'll get two checks. So that's inaccurate. If an employee works in 1 week, if they work at multiple locations, you have to combine all their hours to determine if they worked overtime. And then, of course, a tipped employee, failure to calculate their cash payment correctly, an employer failing to make sure that they made at least enough in tips to bring them up to minimum wage. So those are some common violations we see. These are some additional ones in white-collar exemptions. Sometimes an employer, as I used as an example in professional, they'll say, oh, well, he has a degree, so he's professionally exempt. And so they misapply that exemption. And when in actuality, that individual should be a non-exempt employee. And if they work overtime, they should be compensated. Improper deductions, for instance, deducting for tools or for a uniform, and those deductions bring an employee below minimum wage, or in this instance, since we're talking about overtime, it cuts into their overtime. So the overtime always belongs to the employee. The employer cannot make deductions from overtime earnings. Misclassification of an employee. We usually run into this in like construction, landscaping kind of jobs. The employer will classify somebody as an independent contractor. And so they think that, okay, well, they're an independent contractor, therefore I don't need to pay them, I don't have to make sure, I don't have to keep track of their hours, I don't have to pay their taxes, I don't have, all that comes along with that. Well, there's criteria that have to be met. If a person is a true independent contractor, that means they own their own business. That means they bid for jobs. You're not the only person they're going to work for. They may work for you a longer period of time because you have a good relationship with them, but you know, they carry their own insurance, they advertise, they don't solely depend on your business for their livelihood. And there's like 6 or 7 different criteria that the Supreme Court issued that we look at. I know that the IRS, they look at, I think it's 20 something different factors to determine independent contractor, but there's 6 that we look at when we're looking at independent contractors. So you want to be really careful with that because we see that a lot. And then hours worked, again, failing to record the hours accurately. Sometimes employers will, they either won't have a record of hours or they'll go by a schedule, but that schedule really isn't accurate. So it's real important as an employer, I can't emphasize enough, it's so important for you to keep record of hours. Document on that record of hours. If an employee tells you, I forgot to punch in or I didn't take a lunch, make sure that you record that and that gets passed on to the rest of the supervisors because that's where an employer usually comes into problems, is failing to document. Because when we come on an investigation, the burden of proof is on the employer to disprove that an employee really worked the hours they're claiming to work. So documentation is very, very important. And then of course, confusing state and federal law sometimes can be an issue. Okay, now we're gonna move on to child labor regulations. So the youngest age you can hire is 14, however, for 14 and 15 year olds, there are limitations on the number of hours that they can work. During school time, they can only work 18 hours a week. They can't work past 7 p.m. or before 7 a.m. Once they turn 16, there's no limit on the number of hours that they work. However, there are hazardous occupations that anybody under the age of 18 and under, that there's 17 different hazardous orders that you have to be careful with. You know, in the landscaping, I can think of maybe if you use power-driven machines, operating power-driven equipment, you have to be very careful with that. So what I can do is, if you'd like, I can send you a handy reference guide for all those that are in attendance, and we can mail those to you so that you can have, or you can go online. All that is online. It's called a Fair Labor Standards Act Handy Reference Guide. So just in case you're considering hiring someone that's 18 years or younger, you want to make sure that what they're doing isn't in violation of any of the child labor standards. So record keeping. So this is real important. I talked about documenting the hours of work. So a lot of times we'll come to a business and the employer does record hours, but they throw them away at the end of the pay period. And so we have no records then. So an employer is responsible for keeping their payroll records. So anything that talks about how a person got paid, any kind of document that shows how they got paid, the number of hours they worked, their regular rate, that has to be kept a minimum of 3 years. Their time records have to be kept a minimum of 2 years. Now, we don't require that an employer keep a time clock or any kind of method. As whatever the employer chooses to keep as a time record, that's what we're going to accept. So if they have somebody out in the field that is recording their time in a notebook and then they turn it in at the end of the week, that's fine. We'll take that. That's what we're going to look at. In the absence of records, then the investigator has to really reconstruct the hours based on interviews. And, sometimes that's a little difficult, and sometimes that can be very discouraging on the part of the employer because, the employer may not agree with that. But without proof, then the employer is kind of stuck with that. So record keeping is real important. A poster is very important. The Fair Labor Standards Act poster, it talks about minimum wage and overtime. That has to be kept somewhere where employees kind of congregate, like in a break room, or if you have a time clock and this is where they punch in and out, somewhere where they, where, you know, it's, they're going to frequent and they're going to be at, then that's where it should be kept.
Cindy, we have about 10 minutes left, and we do have one or two questions, so I just wanted to give you an update.
Okay.
Feel free to continue going those 10 minutes, but I'll get the questions after you're finished.
Okay, so basically, I think the most important thing, I guess I can basically stop here because the other stuff just talks about like an investigation. So this is real important when on your, if you keep a time card or whatever you keep for the employee, make sure you keep their full name. A lot of times, I know as an investigator, I ran in to employers who just kept their nickname. And you're responsible for keeping their full name. So their full name, date of birth, if they're under 19, what their rate of pay is, all the deductions you take have to be documented as well. And of course, we talked about posting. These are some things that we don't enforce. We don't enforce vacation, holiday, sick pay. If you fire somebody, there's not, you know, as long as it's reasonable, or I mean, we don't even look at that. That's not something that we, unless it's under the Family Medical Leave Act, we don't enforce that. Let's see. Our statute of limitation is 2 years. So we come into an investigation, we come to your business, we're gonna ask for records, and we're gonna go back 2 years from the time we come into your establishment. So basically that's, penalties, there are civil money penalties that can be assessed if it's a willful violation or if it's child labor. There will be civil money penalties most probably that are assessed. So that's something to consider also. And then these are just some of the regulations that you can go to. You can get them online. You can call our office. I promised our number. It's 210-308-4515. Again, that's 210-308-4515. And you can call, and if you have any questions or you, you know, want to know where you can get any of these reference materials, you can certainly call in. So where do I see the questions?
I will ask them for you.
Okay.
The first question came in. What is the implication of agricultural employees under Fair Labor Standards Act?
Is this H-2A or just regular agricultural employees? Like agricultural employees?
Overtime and pay rates.
Okay, so if somebody is an agricultural employee, there's an exemption from overtime, but you have to make sure that you're paying them at least minimum wage, which is $7.25. Now, if they're brought in to work on an H-2A visa, that's different. So it's whatever the rate is that's on that contract. That's what the employer would be responsible for paying.
Okay, the next question, I'm getting a few questions in here. The next question is, I have a question about the term for application to agriculture. As an example, would five guys who work at least 1 hour in a single day be considered to be 5 man days of labor?
Okay. No, well, I'd have to look that up, and I'm just, so is this somebody who has a nursery as well? I would think it was somebody who has a nursery as well, because regular landscaping, the H-2A would probably apply and it would probably be someone who has a nursing. I would have to look that up. I would be more than welcome, if they can provide their phone number to you, I'll call them back with that.
Okay. All
right. They're talking about the 500 mandates.
Okay. The next question is, if an employee wants more time off than their standard 2 to 3 week vacation, and they ask if they can work extra hours and use this later for days off versus overtime pay now, is that allowed?
No, that's not allowed because an employer, anything that is worked over 40 hours in a work week has to be paid a time and a half. So what they're referring to is what is called comp time, where some people can bank their time. That's only for state and local employees. So that means an employee that works for the city, the county, the state, federal, those employees are allowed to comp to bank hours. But regular private employees, like in the landscaping business, no, that's not allowed.
Okay. And they, are you able to send these slides or make these slides available
yes.
to those who ask?
Yes, I can. I can send the PowerPoint to you if you'd like.
Yes, that would be fine. I can distribute it.
Okay.
Okay. We'll give any more questions from anybody. We'll give just a minute here.
If the person who asked about the 500 mandates, if they can give you their phone number, and I'll call them back. I just need to research
yes.
that. I want to make sure I respond
okay.
accurately.
Okay. Yeah. And he did. So I'll give you that.
Okay.
Great. After the presentation. It looks like
okay.
I don't have any other questions coming through. So thank you again, Cindy. We just appreciate you being here with us today. Appreciate you sharing your knowledge and also sharing your talents. We want to also thank our sponsor, Hotchkiss Insurance Agency. Thank them for everything they're doing for us. We did have a quick question. I think this kind of goes back. Do you have a handy reference guide and fact sheets that you can send me as well, Cindy?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
all
it's
right.
online,
so,
and we'll send you the link.
Okay, very good.
Okay.
Well, I appreciate everybody
great.
Being here today. And Cindy, thank you again. And I hope everybody has a great rest of the week and a safe Labor Day weekend. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.